Hey, we got a good thing. Don't know if I'ma see you again. But is that a good thing?
Radio show in the nation where Eagle Pride
is amplified
always. Now, Tony, we got another one.
Another one.
And it's so amazing because the last time they were here, they was talking about printing the book. Now, the book is already here. The book is already here. We got D. Clark and Company back with us again. How are you ladies doing?
Hey, we're doing good. We're doing good. Thanks for having us back.
No problem. So, she's valuable, but does she know it?
Yeah.
Just tell us about the book. Just tell us about this whole book. What is this whole book about?
So initially, I'm a matchmaker and relationship coach, just to refresh you guys' memory. Mm-hmm. And I work with so many amazing women who know their professional worth. They've got their degrees. They've climbed the corporate ladder. They're entrepreneurs. But when it came to their personal value and worth, they didn't know it. And I'd ask them, you know, why are you? What makes you valuable? What value will you add to a relationship? And they had no idea. Mm-hmm. And it reflected in the decisions they were making in the dating space. They were settling. They were involved with men who didn't really appreciate all of who they were. So I initially created a coaching program for them,
right.
And I realized I had so much content and there was so much value in that information that it was important not only for the women that I coached, but for the women outside,
right.
All over, on college campuses, adult women, and even in high school. So I said, I gotta write this book, get it in the hands of every woman that I know so that she can start working in her truth, owning who she is, and not being afraid to communicate it.
So the title, She's Valuable But Does She Know It?
Yes.
Why did you choose that title?
Because every woman, whether she knows it or not, whether her daddy told her, whether, you know, her mom told her, whether, you know, society will share that with her, is valuable. We all are uniquely created and have gifts and talents within the depths of us that only each of us can express and put out there, and only each of us can do.
Mm-hmm.
And even outside of that, we're all beautiful in our own way. No matter your skin tone, no matter how long your hair is, no matter your body shape, you're valuable and you need to know that. But the problem is, not everybody knows it.
Mm-hmm.
And so I needed that title, one, to say, listen, you're valuable, to affirm whoever it is that picks up this book immediately. But do you know it, to bring it in and say, have you really thought about what makes you valuable?
Mm-hmm.
Have you really taken the time to think about all the amazing qualities that you possess?
Right.
And not be afraid to express it or look at it as maybe this, you know, it may be small to you, but it could be something that really impacts someone else's life.
Exactly.
It could be that very thing that helps you make the best decision in a relationship and get you out of that abusive relationship,
mm-hmm.
with someone who could really value and treat you in the manner that you're deserving. And so I needed women to know that, first off, you're valuable.
Mm-hmm.
If you don't know it, I'm getting ready to tell you and show you how to identify that.
So what are some key things that you would tell women on how, what makes them valuable? Like, if somebody was to come to you and say, well, you know, I mean, I know I'm pretty, you know, I know I'm a cute girl, but like, I just don't feel like it sometimes. What is your response to that?
Well, the first response is, it has nothing to do with your looks. The looks, you're pretty, your shape, your complexion, the length of your hair, that's only like the icing on the cake. That's the stuff that doesn't really matter. What matters is your character. What matters is who you are on the inside. What matters is the fact that you are a giving person that is pouring out into the world, into a generation of people that need you, that you're not afraid to say, you know what? I had a hard upbringing.
Mm-hmm.
I didn't have a silver spoon fed, but I overcame that, and now my testimony is something that will save lives. It's those women, that's what I'm trying to get them to tap into, to say that, listen, there is more than me, to me, than the outside. There's so much on the inside of me that I have to offer the world, and that's what makes me valuable first.
Mm-hmm. Okay, yeah. So I'm gonna go through some of these chapters.
Yeah.
So the first chapter is judging myself through someone else's eyes.
Yes.
Talk to me about that.
So that is actually my story. I'll share briefly. There was an experience that I had in middle school. I was a basketball player, and I just loved this guy. He was so dope. He looked
mm-hmm.
cute. We were like the same height. We both played basketball, you know, and I'm like, this would be a match made
goals.
In heaven.
That was goals, right?
Yeah.
Goals.
He was popular, you know, and I went to DSA, and DSA is a big campus, and so we saw each other walking across the campus. He starts approaching me, and he begins to, like, give me a dap, and as soon as we shake hands, he says, oh, my God, your hands are so rough. You cut me. It's like sandpaper.
Mm-hmm.
Everybody around started laughing. They started judging me from that moment on, and I felt horrible. I started having self-doubt,
mm-hmm.
having low self-esteem, feeling like I would never be, a man would never want me because they want someone with soft hands. And in my mind, I'm thinking, oh, my hands are so rough, and it really wasn't that bad.
Mm-hmm.
But to him, and the way he made it seem to the crowd, it made me feel like there was nothing valuable about me in that moment.
Right.
And so what I had to allow, one of people to realize through the story is, and other stuff that I share in that chapter, is that we have to stop judging our value and our worth on what how other people perceive us mm-hmm. and what they think is great about us and not great about us. And we have to stop giving people power over where we see ourselves and how beautiful we are, and allowing society to say, this is what makes a woman beautiful. You know, if you don't have this and you don't do this, then there's no way that you can be valuable. Mm-hmm. And we have to stop doing that. And for a long time, for years, I wouldn't shake hands. I would say I'm a hugger. While we were in prayer in church, I couldn't think about the content of the prayer because I was so concerned about, is the person thinking about my hands that's holding me?
Oh, so you had to hold somebody's wrist like this.
I would hold their hands Well, let me just hold their shirt. You know what? It affected me in so many ways for years. And so I wanted people to realize that we can give people so much power over our lives mm-hmm. that affects our behavior, the things that we do, the things that we can't think that we can't do, right. the people that we engage with, the fact that we can't even get tuned into a prayer so much because mm-hmm. we're so concerned about what the person to the left and the right of us is thinking. And so that story was important for me to share because I needed people to know that you can't judge yourself based off how other people may perceive you.
Okay, now let me ask you this.
Yeah.
Now, before we go on, how do we as men value our women more? Because, like, if you look through society, you know what I'm saying? Look through society today, a lot of women are changing who they are because some men, I've been in a situation where some men have dogged out women or they've made them feel some type of way and they've carried that burden for years. So how do we as men value women more?
Well, one, you need to stay off social media and stay off social media.
Wait, what?
We have all these IG models, right, that are flaunting their bodies and all the
fake.
Big booties here, all fake. And it looks good, right? You're scrolling through, you're like, oh, okay.
It looks nice.
It looks nice. But you start judging and comparing every girl to that standard. You start thinking, oh, okay, well, I need somebody with this shape. I need somebody mm-hmm. this complexion. I need somebody that's revealing and showing this. So you got to stay off social media mm-hmm. and start defining what beauty is to you. And then here's another thing that I always think young men should do, and women, but more so men. Get somebody in your life who is a good man in his community, who has a good, healthy relationship with a woman who's not, you know, Victoria's Next Top Model, but a real woman who's beautiful in her own right, but has more to her, has more substance than the outside. And follow after that man. See how he's interacting with women, how he's treating women. If he has daughters, how he's raising his daughters and interacting with his daughter, how he's affirming them. If it's not your own father, get a positive male figure in your life that treats women with the respect that they deserve and let them know, and lets them know that, hey, you're worthy, you're valuable, and treats them in that manner. Get a man like that in your life, because there's a lot of times that we feel people in our circle who are not right, who are negative, who are mm-hmm. chasing after the wrong things mm-hmm. with no substance, without purpose, without meaning, and we can get caught up in that. You gotta start putting people in your circle that will help advance you in every area of your life, and especially in women, because relationships, the person that you choose to be with, is gonna affect you for the rest of your life.
Exactly.
I just want to stop by and show love. I'm your babe.
Hi.
Yes, I have to come down for that. Yes. Yes, I'm validating. I'm preaching.
Yes.
Listen, I love what you're saying. I have a question as well, real
quick. Okay, yes.
So there's an article that I read, I think it was on the Huffington Post, where a woman, you know, she has three sons, right? And she says she walks around nude to show them that this is the body of a female, the natural body of a woman, especially after childbirth. So she bears nothing, you know what I'm saying, with them.
She brave.
Right. Like, she walks around
with that.
So she has three boys. They're all, I think the oldest is like maybe 6 or 7 years old.
Okay.
And she wants them to understand that this is what a real woman looks like. You know what I'm saying? This is what, not what you see on TV or the things like that.
Like this right here.
Yes.
Get this right here. Like this right here.
Yeah, we
this
talk
what all women look like,
so
okay?
How do you feel about that concept? And I'm gonna drop that jewel.
Yeah.
Because I gotta run back to class real quick. But how do you feel about that concept?
Yeah, I definitely think it's an extreme concept,
right.
But I get the point of it, because even I'm a mother of two girls. I have a 3-year-old and a 1-year-old.
Mm-hmm,
and as women, we naturally question, like, oh my God, my boobs aren't as big as they used to be, and
right.
maybe something's hanging, and maybe I have a stretch mark there. So you begin to question yourselves.
Mm-hmm.
But you have that man in your life, my husband, who I've been with since 16 years old. We're high school sweethearts.
Oh, wow.
He doesn't want more, anything other than what I've given.
Right.
He appreciates me for who I am and realizes that you just did something twice that could have taken your life,
mm-hmm.
that's giving me more meaning in life, because now I'm a father and I have children.
Mm-hmm.
And he really helps to affirm me in who I am, right, no matter what my body looks like now, before, that's after, just. But I think it's amazing. I love what she's doing because she's starting to instill important values in her sons at an early age, which is when it needs to happen. So now when they get older, they're not going to be looking for the Kim K's and Khloe Kardashians. Right, they're going, right, to be looking for someone with some substance, someone that when they do become a parent can be a great mentor to their children, could you know, instill values and a great family foundation in their children and for them. Because guess what? If it wasn't for men, I'm not trying to toot my own horn, mm-hmm, I don't think my husband would be as far along as he is, because every man needs a woman who's got her head on straight, right, who, you know, has, who can think for herself, right, and can help empower their husband. And it takes more, mm-hmm, to keep them, right, stimulated than just sexy photos, contoured face, and, right, long weave. You, mm-hmm, know what I mean? So you got to be able to add more. And that's why I ask women at the front of this, at the top of this book, what makes you valuable? What value will you add to a relationship? You know, it has that iceberg effect where you see the top of it, the glacier, you know, looks nice, but underneath that, there's so much. Right. You don't see that big rock at the end of that. There's so much substance. That's the same way we have to treat it. Right. Yeah, I'm cute on the outside. I got a little makeup on, but, okay, inside of me, mm-hmm, there's so much more, mm-hmm, once you get the opportunity to tap into that.
Now,
I love that. Thank you.
Yeah.
Now, it's funny that you said, all right. Now, it's funny that you say that, because now I want to go into chapter two, because chapter two, that spoke a lot of value. Bleached skin and empty pockets.
Yeah.
Talk to me about that, because that's heavy right,
yeah,
there.
Yeah. So this story is about a young lady who actually started out at North Carolina Central University. She, very positive athlete, you know, was on the honor roll, you know, destined for success, and she's very successful now. But she lived in an interesting dichotomy at home. She had her father, who was a pastor, winning souls for Christ, mm-hmm, and her mother, who was addicted to drugs. And, mm-hmm, so her mother, who she didn't want to show up at her basketball games because she was embarrassed by the behavior that she may have, mm-hmm, she looked exactly like her, but she wanted no association with her. She felt like, how could I be valuable as an African-American woman when my mother is sitting home and choosing the recreation of drugs as opposed to being a present parent in my life, mm-hmm, and being a positive role model for me? So she didn't want any association with it. She saw more value in the white children at school whose mothers were there and president of PTA and all that stuff. So she thought, there's got to be more value in those people. Mm-hmm. I need to look like that in order for people to see value in me. Right. So she began to bleach her skin because she no longer wanted to be an African American woman. She saw no value in that,
wow,
because of the what was happening with her mother. And then to support her drug habit, her mother would go through and cut the pants pockets of their kids to get loose change to support her drug addiction. And so not only was she trying to protect her identity, she was also trying to protect her pockets, mm-hmm, and keep the money in there. And that story is so strong and has impacted so many people's lives. Because how often have we found ourselves not wanting to associate with something that we thought was, you know, mom and dad, you know, that who should be, you know, influential and putting us on the right step and choosing to be parents as opposed to other things that won't really help sustain us and build us as individuals. How often have we said, oh, I don't want any part of that? And to take it to the extent of, I now need to bleach my skin because I see no value in being an African-American woman, that is powerful. Mm-hmm. And so I needed that story to be shared. But now her mother is 17 plus years clean.
Amen.
She started a movement to help other women eradicate their drug habits, mm-hmm, and, you know, use their testimony to save other women. And now she's like, I wouldn't have it anyway. I love my mother. I support my, mm-hmm, mother. And now not only she's a mother herself of two girls, not only is she a positive influence to her girls, but now her children are saying, I want to be like grandmother. I want to, mm-hmm, do something like grandma and start a movement to empower other, mm-hmm, women. And so now that it's full circle, I mean, it's phenomenal.
Fatherless daughters.
Fatherless,
how important,
daughters,
is that? Fatherless daughters.
Well, you know, fathers are so important to us. They are who confirms our beauty. They confirm that we matter, that we're enough. They are the people that help set the standard of the type of men that we invite in our lives. And so with me being a woman who had a father but who wasn't present and active in my life, this particular story is actually about a young woman who graduated from North Carolina Central just this May,
mm-hmm,
about her father who ended up leaving her. Was a great part of her life when she was a kid, and then out of nowhere, for whatever reasons, which you'll find in the book, he decides to leave her. Mm-hmm. And so that became a repetition in every relationship in her life. A man would be there, a guy would be there, he'd like her at the beginning, they'd be together for X amount of months or a year, and then for some reason he left. And so she developed the mentality that I'm not good enough for a man to stay.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not lovable for a man to stay with me past a certain amount of time. And so not having a father there to say, no, you're enough. You're worthy. You're valuable. You're deserving of a loving and healthy long relationship with a man deterred her from ever believing in that. And so now she doesn't think that. But that was so hard for her, for not having a man. And you know what I share in the book is not even just having a father. Anytime there is something absent from our lives that we feel like, you know, gosh, I thought my mother was going to be this to me. I thought my dad was going to be that. I thought my friends were going to do this. I thought my pastor was going to be that. God always finds a way to replace that mm-hmm. void with something else. Mm-hmm. It may not be what you thought, but it's always going to be someone to fill that void and instill in you the things that you may have lacked or right. didn't get from that other source that you thought you were supposed mm-hmm. to get it from. And so I thought that story was important to share.
Now, you have something in here where you say take action about reclaiming your value. You say yes. Step one. Be so honest with yourself that it hurts.
Yeah.
What do you mean by that?
So a lot of times we get in our own way because we're not honest with ourselves about the things that are holding us back. We're not honest about the fact that, yeah, I don't really think I'm pretty. And, you know, daddy wasn't there for me. Or, you know, I am struggling with self-confidence. Because a lot of times we like to put on.
Right.
We put on the makeup. We put on the cute clothes. We're walking around like everything's okay. But on the inside, we're hurting. On the inside, you know, we are battling addiction. We're going through domestic violence. We're going through all sorts of things that we're not, we are too afraid to be honest with and put out on the table. And it's that very thing that will help turn our situation around. When you are honest with yourself about the thing that is holding you back, then that's the first step in changing it and putting a process in place to make it better so that you can really propel into your future, so that you can really position yourself to attract love and the right type of relationship with the person that's going to treat you mm-hmm. with the respect that you deserve. And so you got to be honest with yourself. For me, I had to be honest with myself that, hey, I was treating myself poorly and speaking negatively into myself because of what other people had shared with me. Mm-hmm. And I'm walking around with great personality, bubbly and all this stuff, but no, I'm hurting. And so I had to be honest with that and not be afraid to share that I'm flawed.
Right.
You know, and it wasn't until I did that I started to live. I started to walk in my truth and to really walk in or own the fact that, hey, I am valuable, and realize that there are some mm-hmm. good things about me despite what my past has to say.
Because I've seen in certain situations, for example, there was a certain young lady that I know. She was in a relationship with a guy, and, you know, she really, really liked him. He gave her what he wanted. You know, of course, they had a few bumps in the road, but she will always have a lot of insecurity issues because, you know, of course, he was very friendly with other girls, and, you know, she would think that they would look better than her. And she had a hard problem with understanding that, you know, like, she felt like the other girls are better than her. And I remember, like, one time he said he's going to look at other girls, but he doesn't look at other girls the way he looks at you, the way I look at you. And she didn't really understand it. So how can girls understand, like, in a relationship? Like, okay, let me say this. How do girls know when they have a good man that actually treats them well?
Well, one of the things that I say is, if someone is more interested than interesting, they are interested in building a relationship with you. They're interested in learning about you, who you are. And then they make you a priority. Mm-hmm. They're spending time with you. They're introducing you to their friends. They're making you a part of their life. And they're not afraid to do that. And then they're pouring into you. They're helping to grow you. They're helping to make you a better person. Those are all signs of someone who is into you've got a good man mm-hmm. who wants to be with you. Now, I was that same girl. I dated my high school sweetheart. When we went to college, I went to Hampton University. He went to Virginia State. Mm-hmm. I'm like, oh my God, there's so many pretty girls at Virginia State. You know, mm-hmm. is he really going to be faithful towards me? And every chance I got when he would visit me, I would question his loyalty. I'd question his commitment towards me. And he's like, wait, I'm here. I'm here at Hampton every weekend. You know, what else do I have? I'm communicating with you all the time.
Right.
But it was hard for me to believe, mainly because of my past and my daddy wasn't there and he was a rolling stone and, you know, stepped out on the marriage with my mom, that any man could be faithful to me, especially being a part. But it was something that I had to work on myself. He couldn't change that. He couldn't help me believe that he was a good guy. I had to go through the work within myself. I had to get over the insecurity. I had to get over the self-doubt and realize that if he's going to be with me, if he's who I'm supposed to be with, I'm going to be with him. And if he's going to step out on me, I have to give him room to do that.
Right.
I can't just automatically say, oh, he's going to cheat. You're cheating on me when he hasn't proven otherwise.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and sometimes we have to give people a chance to be who they say they're going to be to us, as opposed to automatically putting them in a category that their actions haven't shown they're deserving of being in.
Okay. Now, this is another thing, Antonio, I saw. short hair don't care. But this is the thing. She has a quote by Oprah where it says, as you become more clear about who you really are, you'll be better able to decide what is best for you the first time around.
Yeah.
So talk about that short hair don't care.
So short hair don't care was about a young lady who was on the campus of Hampton University or Howard University. She pretty long hair, light skin. She had that whole LL complex. Mm-hmm. And she was really excited. Her and her girlfriends got together. They said, oh, we're going to cut our hair. We're going to, you know, switch it up a little bit. Mm-hmm. There was a campus party. So after they cut their hair, they went on campus. And she was excited to see her boyfriend to show her this new look. And when he sees her at the party, he immediately says, whoa, what's going on here? What did you do? And he uses that same line I just used. He said, you just lost that whole, like, LL complex that I liked you for. Light skin, long hair. And he dumped her right there in the middle of the party. And so for a long time, she was so self-conscious about her hair and how she had to look and what she had to be in order to keep a man. Mm-hmm. And so short hair don't care. It's like, no, if I decide to cut my hair,
it's your hair. Okay,
it's my hair.
Right.
And you staying with me shouldn't have any effect on that.
Mm-hmm.
And so, but it took her a long time to get over that. And so Oprah's quote I thought was so important for this chapter is that when you know who you are, when you realize that, hey, my worth is not determined by the length of my hair, by the complexion of my skin, I could have made the best decision for me and realized that that guy wasn't right for me from the beginning.
Mm-hmm.
And so now I put myself in a situation where now I'm doubting and questioning myself in an area that I never did before, you know, because of what I've allowed someone, because of the decision I made by not knowing who I was and walking in and owning all of that. And so that's so important. You'll make the decision, the best decision for yourself the first time around when you know and own all of who you are.
Now, the last thing I want to touch on, because I know it's a lot of chats, but this one just caught my eye as well. You, my dear, are powerful. The moment anyone tries to demean or degrade you in any way, you have to know how great you are. Nobody would bother to beat you down if you were not a threat. Cicely Tyson.
Oh, God. First of all, hands, just praise to Cicely Tyson. She is such an amazing figure in the African-American community, community, especially for African-American women. But that was so powerful because a lot of times we look at other people criticizing us or judging us, you know, as, oh my God, they're thinking so poorly of me. When it's actually an issue going on within them.
Mm-hmm.
They are threatened by whatever it is that we are presenting at the moment, our abilities, our gifts, our beauty. They're threatened by that. And there's something going on the inside of them that's not allowing them to appreciate or celebrate all the things that we are. Mm-hmm. As opposed to supporting us, they're hating us. As opposed to lifting us up and celebrating the things that make you great, they're finding some way to sabotage that by what they think, saying negative things to you and bringing you down and preventing you from moving forward and whatever it is that they're hating on you on.
Mm-hmm.
I was a victim of that. When I was in high school, I played basketball, I played volleyball, I was running for homecoming queen, and a lot of people said, oh no, you shouldn't do that, you know, the more popular girls, you know, the girls who were, 'cause see, I wore Tim's, my Air Force Ones, you know, I wasn't wearing heels and stuff, and
that's a cool girl in my book.
But I allowed someone to get in my head to think I couldn't be homecoming queen because I didn't embody this certain look. But I said, you know what? I'm going to do it anyway. Not only did I win homecoming queen, but I won prom queen too because I knew who I was. And I realized that it was a threat on other people's behalf that they didn't want to see me in that space. Not everybody's for you. Not everybody's cheering for you.
Right.
And so you have to realize that those people are wounded. Mm-hmm. They're hurt. They're insecure. They're going through self-doubt. They're not confident in who they are. And so they're threatened by someone who's able to walk in their truth and be confident in all they are.
So what would you say, what do you hope that people, especially women, get from this book?
The main thing is to shift your mindset. Mm-hmm. It's all here, what we think, what we allow to come in and out of our minds, and who we allow to implant them in there. We don't have control of that. Sometimes stuff comes in and it's up to you to decide what to do with it. So the biggest takeaway is get control of your mind and your thoughts and realize and have something immediately, which is why I have that 30-day devotional at the end. We have to start equipping ourselves with the right words to speak against those negative things that often are presented in our minds with us every day with social media, with, you know, men saying degrading things about women, we have to be able to have stuff, an arsenal of words to fight back. So a big part of that is taking control of your mind and your thoughts and being able to speak against that. And a big part of that is knowing who you are. When you have control of your thoughts, when you have control of your mind, you have control of your reality and what's happening to you and who you allow to happen to you. Mm-hmm. When you don't have control of your thoughts and you allow people to implant negative things and negative words into your life, that starts festering, you start believing that, and it becomes truth and it becomes your reality. But when you take control of your thoughts and your mind, you're able to fight back those things that come, replace it with something positive, and change the destination of your life in a different direction. So you gotta get control of your thoughts and your mind. That's the biggest takeaway. And once you do that, you can walk in all of your glory, mm-hmm. and say, listen, I'm amazing. I'm a dope chick. You know, I'm anybody right. who gets the chance to date me, meet me, it's an honor. Mm-hmm. You have to have that type of mindset. Mm-hmm. And without having that, you're subjected to be anything and everything that the world says you should or should not be.
Okay, now let me ask you a question. How did you know that you are valuable? Like, how did you know for a fact?
So, actually, I was a part of the mastermind group with Dominique, and when she came looking for the book. So, when she first came, I didn't know. It was hard for me to answer that question. I was a freshman here. I was confused. I did not know. And I knew I was valuable continuing to work with Dominique when I looked in the mirror and I was like, you know what? I am dope. Nobody can touch me. Nobody right. can tell me that I am not, I'm not valuable, I'm not beautiful, that I don't bring greatness to the table, because I do, because I'm just that dope. So I think over time, you know, every day I told myself, you're valuable. Every day, you're beautiful. My mom, she made me sing a song when I was younger. I used to say, I'm so cute. But I think, when you have to say it. They say if you do something 7 times in a row, you know, you continue
seven
to do it.
7 is the number of completion.
Yeah, mm-hmm. you know, you continue to do it. So I think every day that I told myself, I begin to believe it.
Right.
The more I told myself, the more my actions, the more I positioned myself with other valuable people, other people that knew that they were valuable. That's when I really knew, when I continued to look at myself and I began to believe what I was saying.
So what would your message be? Because you're still here, essentially, right?
Am.
Okay, mm-hmm. What's your classification?
I'm a junior/senior, graduation next December. So you know.
All right. So, but that being said, what would your message be to that freshman who is struggling to find herself, who does not think that she's worth anything, and that men around here tell her, like, you're not worth nothing. Like, she's that one girl where she has pretty friends, and they always choose the pretty friends, but they never choose her. What would your message be to that girl?
My message to that girl is to love you.
Mm-hmm.
To love you. Don't look at anybody else, because God created us each different. He created all of us with different shapes, different sizes, different everything. So love you. So continue just to love you and not look at other people, because mm-hmm. we're never going to amount to, you know, any
other
person.
Well, and the biggest thing is you don't know what somebody else is going through.
You don't.
You look at this person on the mm-hmm. outside and you don't realize that they're hurting on the inside. You're idolizing somebody and thinking, oh my God, they're so great, when you have no idea what they go through when they close that door when they get home.
Right.
Yeah.
And so that's the biggest reason why you have to be careful about judging yourself against other women in a circle, because you don't know what they're going through.
Mm-hmm.
And they could be idolizing you. I was that girl mm-hmm. who was in a group of all light-skinned friends at Hampton mm-hmm. University, and all the
right.
girls were checking for them. And I'm like, but you know what? This chocolate skin is kind of cute too,
yeah,
you know?
Right.
But for a long time, I was bothered by that, because I couldn't understand that why. And it wasn't that they didn't see the beauty in me. It also had to do with behavior and certain things that were happening that made the other girl seem a little bit more free,
right.
and I don't mm-hmm. want to use other, but you mm-hmm. get what I'm saying? That, so you have to be careful. And they would say to me, well, we knew we couldn't come to you with that.
Mm-hmm.
And so in hindsight, I'm like, oh, okay, I get it now. But then mm-hmm. I was thinking, gosh, no one wants me. But they knew that if they came to me, they had to come correct.
Right.
You have to come correct. I'm a dope chick. Mm-hmm. Like she said, I mean, this is an honor. I mean,
right.
So for example,
like what is the right, so if a guy was trying to get to know you, try to like holler at you, what would be the right approach for him?
Are you asking her?
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. You know, flip hair. you know, I think it's really nice when a young man says, you know what, you're beautiful. I think in our generation now, I think sometimes young, we come and like, oh, you fine, you sexy. That's not cute. That's not hot. But it's, I think it's really nice when young, when you come correct, you say, you know, you're beautiful. Or, you know, I like that shirt that you have on today. Or things like that. I think sometimes we get away from the little cutesy stuff. You know, can I take you out to lunch one day? Can I walk you to the calf? Can I walk you to your class today? You know, things like that. But that whole, that's what I think, like, definitely I've noticed in my generation is it's the whole thing of, like, you're sexy. Try again. You know, let's try again. So that whole, just come and correct with your tone and things of that sort.
Now, let me ask you something. Do you think this book is going to be able to reach women, especially on HBCU campuses?
Absolutely, which is why I included the story of a recent graduate. She just graduated in May. And her story is Fatherless Daughters. In that book, the good thing about this book and the message is that it transcends generations. We did our book launch at BU Cafe 2 weeks ago, yesterday, or tomorrow will be 2 weeks.
Yep.
And there were women of all ages who were empowered by the message of this book. The college women, we just started working with 100 Black Women, and this book will be the book of choice for their book club. And so already girls are saying, oh my goodness, this is helping me so much. I'm able to now look at things in a different way. You're helping me so much by just the content in the book. And so one of the things that I did on purpose was to make sure that the language in the book was interpreted well by women of all ages, which is why when I did the research for the book, I did masterminds with groups of women in college, groups of women that were in their 50s, 20s, and 30s, so that every woman could identify, find a piece of herself in one of those stories or in that book, and be able to use the information to help them in some way.
For men, what can some men take away from this book as well?
So the good thing about this book, and I've had men purchase this book, and one guy, well, two guys, one guy said that this was going to be a great conversation piece between him and his daughter, because he wanted to make sure that I think her mother wasn't had passed away, and so it was just him, and he needed information like this to help her and have this conversation with her through that she's 15 now, and so she's at that stage where she's trying to figure out who am I, and you know, is she trying to conform to social media models and stuff like that. And so he thought this is going to be a great conversation piece. But what men could take away from this book is an understanding of what we go through as women, and the things that sometimes are happening in our mind that you may not see, that you may not realize after having an encounter with us, and so that you know how the next time to maybe communicate, or not necessarily give so much praise to the wrong type of women, because the good women, it makes us feel like, well, gosh, that's what men want. So me being a good girl doesn't even matter. Me having my stuff together doesn't even matter, because they celebrate this woman over here who's on reality TV fighting and looking crazy, but she has a cute body and she has a good look, you know, and she's got her makeup done. And so it's a great conversation piece. It's a great eye-opener to what we go through as women. And I think it'll give you a good understanding of who we are and how to interact and engage with us moving forward.
Okay. Well, thank you for coming by. I think this book is powerful, honestly. I think it's something that almost every girl, especially Black girls, need to read, because I think this is going to be able to reach out girls in certain communities that have insecurity issues, infidelity issues. Like, I think, like, this is something that each woman should look at, because, you know, as men, we don't understand what you women go through. We don't understand that. We think we know, but we really don't know until you all tell us that. And it's like, oh man, well, I didn't know all of that. And it's like, yeah, I know you did.
Yeah.
But I think it's like, so it's like, I think this book is very, very valuable. So we're going to support this book. Yeah. I would tell everybody, please go cop this book. This book is an amazing book by an amazing author.
Yeah.
I'm sure you said they were. First of all, look at the cover. First of all, the cover is dope right now.
Yes.
This is her on the back right here. Like, please purchase this book. It's really worth it. And thank you guys for coming by. And of course,
where can you purchase it?
Where can you purchase that?
That's so you can get the book at dclarkandcompany.com, my website, or you can go to Amazon, barnesandnoble.com, or booksamillion.com. Make sure to still follow the movement, She's Valuable Movement, on Instagram and Twitter at she's_valuable. And you could also follow me on Instagram and Twitter, too, at dclarkandco, or dclark.
You want to give any shout-outs?
Shout out to this amazing woman right here who's been with me from the start, and just Central North Carolina Central University as a whole, because they have really embraced the movement. Mm-hmm. They've embraced me as an author and matchmaker, and have opened so many doors for me to come in and speak to the female population here. So I'm very grateful. And to you guys for having me again. No problem. So I really, really appreciate that.
No problem.
Yep.
All right, well, thank you so much for coming by. This is The Juice, the hottest hottest HBCU radio station in the nation. Stay locked. But is that a good thing? 'Cause girl, I can't be your man.